Good evening, sports fans. Welcome to a special episode of Sports Desk as we celebrate our second year anniversary. I'm Gina Rufino.
We have special guests tonight, champions and personalities from different sports in the country. I'm Cesca Litton.
Tonight, we have an open forum discussion on Philippine sports with some of the biggest names to ever play their respective sports. I'm Mico Halim.
Joined on the set with some of the best, and we start off with football player who has a part of the Ascals when the football movement started and the Philippines took notice. Anton del Rosario.
How's it going?
Our next guest is a champion, a most valuable player, and one of the best to play the sport of volleyball in the country, and she's not even close to being done. She's still in her prime. Aby Marano.
Hi, everyone.
Next up is the MVP of Season 77 of the UAAP. He is the future of Philippine basketball, the one and only phenom, Kiefer Ravena.
Hello, good evening.
With his versatility, he not only took the PBA by storm, but also represented the Philippines in several international tournaments, including the historical Gilas run in the FIBA World Cup earlier this year. Gabe Norwood.
Good evening.
Thanks for having me.
And finally, we have one of the greatest players to ever play in the PBA, along with several stints playing for flag and country. And we just love how honest he is off camera. His clutch gene gave him the nickname Mr. Fourth Quarter, Jojo Lastimosa.
Hello, guys.
Good evening and welcome to Sports Desk. It's wow, having you guys here, truly an honor for the second year anniversary, especially you, Mico Hedy.
It's a privilege to be here.
Hello, Daddy Minion.
Yeah. You know, and of course, Mico, it's you know, having everybody here, different sports, different personalities in the studio. And you, because you know, Cesca and I were here last year, but you being part now of this historical occasion.
Oh,
what does it mean for you? Before we get to the guests,
well, honored. Yeah, you honored. Asked me before honored. All of these guys. Huh? No. I think I'd like to congratulate Gino, Cesca, and the entire Sports Desk team for a fantastic job. You know, putting the show together every night, and I think it's so fitting that we have such great athletes here to share their experiences, share their thoughts, share their views. It's, you know, it's every night you guys deliver the news, but tonight we are going to give insights.
Yeah.
I mean, really rich insights about what it means to be an athlete and what it means to compete. Now, since we have an all-star lineup, it's only appropriate we begin with the stellar careers of our guests tonight. I'm sure we all have our own favorite moments involving Anton and Gabe and Aby, Jolas and Kiefer, but let's listen to their own stories, meaning, you know, let's find out what are their favorite career moments.
All right. Well, let's start over here. Anton.
Yes.
what is your favorite career moment so far, whether it's as an ASCAL or in the
or
UFL?
Or playing for CSA in high school. I don't know.
Oh, man. CSA back in the day, number one. Nah. Well, I got to say, you know, the most important game must have been with the ASCALs. You know, I mean, it's a game that changed everything, the vision of football in the country, and that was against Vietnam in 2010 in the Suzuki Cup. I mean, we came out, we were the underdogs of the tournament, and we played the number one team, the team who won the tournament previously, and we ended up beating them 2-0. And I mean, it was like overnight sort of celebrities. Everybody started talking about football, caring about football, and now it is what it is today.
Do you think that social media had something to do with it? Because during that time, Twitter, Facebook, everything was blowing up and everything was all about the ASCALs.
Of course. I mean, social media is the best way to market these days. I mean, everybody goes through social media. So if you need something to get out to the people, all you got to do is send out a tweet and then you know, one person retweets it, another person retweets it, and goes out to millions of people, you know? So, I mean, social media had a big impact on, I guess, where the sport is today.
Okay.
All right, Gabe?
Well, hands down for me was, you know, being here in Manila, hosting FIBA Asia and beating Korea. That's easily the highlight of my career. You know, I've been blessed to be on some pretty good teams from, you know, growing up in the States and, you know, winning a high school championship, playing in a Final Four in college. But easily, hands down, was being there in Moa. You know, I get a little choked up. But no, but seriously, you know, I have my wife and kids there. You know, I have my Lola in the States tuned in, and she's calling, and, you know, there's nothing like it. So that's easily the highlight of my career.
Aby?
Hi. For me now, since I'm no longer playing for collegiate, I'm playing for a semi-professional league. I got to get an award, which is best blocker in 3 different tournaments. Consecutive siya, kaya sobrang medyo highlight talaga yun ng
career ko. Medyo chillax ka lang, no? Consecutive tournaments.
The first one was from PSL. Mm-hmm. It's an all-Filipino league, Philippine Superliga, and then the other one was from Shakey's V-League, and then the other one also was from Philippine Superliga again, Grand Prix naman this time.
So, medyo dominant talaga.
Kasi yung first year high school ko, I was the first one out of Ateneo grade school making it to the team. Then na si Sir Mico.
Si Coach Magaw na start maging team manager.
Nandun na siya.
Bata pa.
Nandun na siya na yung team manager namin. So he was able to witness one of my best games to start my career talaga against the Salzobel. Although we lost, pero it's memorable kasi parang that was the time where people took notice of me, a 13-year-old player, just of grade school, being able to play with the big guys already. So, memorable siya kasi, yun nga, umalis na rin si Coach Mico noon after noon, iniwan ako, so.
So, sabi nga ni Mico that he had no choice and he had a problem. Like, we can't cut him. We have to include him in the lineup. He's giving us
a
problem.
That's a true story. Pinag-isipan namin si Kiefer because he was so young.
Fantastic game.
Yeah, but yun nga, I think he scored 24.
Summer league, yeah,
24
summer
points.
League. Summer League. That was a summer league.
Yun. But you scored like how many 3-point shots? Yeah. Kalaban FU. Yeah. So that was the. We had to decide. I mean, this kid was too good not to put in the lineup.
It was too difficult. Okay, Jolas, this might take some time.
Yeah.
This might take a long time.
I was wondering when the guys were introduced. I was the last one. Is it because of age or what? Yeah, I got that. But I have to go back. I always get asked about yung memorable games, and I always go back to 1986 in Asian Games in Seoul, Korea. Again, when you play for flag, I was talking to Kiefer, this is always really an honor to play for your flag. And I was 22 years old. I was a bench player, but we won bronze over, I think, Korea. Is that Korea? Or Japan, against Japan.
And that was an all-amateur team.
And we, in the crossover game, we lost by 2 points against Korea. But in the championship game, in the bronze medal game against Japan, we won that. And I don't think I played, but I celebrated like crazy. So it was a golden bronze, and for me, it was fantastic. I mean, it was for me the pinnacle of my short young career.
Young career.
You're still young.
22 ba?
the young career. We call this Ali. Anton. I always get you guys mixed up because you guys are my brothers from a long time ago. My bad, Anton. But Ton, let's go back to that Suzuki Cup because that was a special moment in football. Because before that, you were part of that Ascals team when nobody really took notice too much of the team until you started winning. So talk a little bit about how finally, wow, we're getting some attention. Finally, it took this long, but it's worth it.
Yeah, I mean, well, I started playing with the national team in, what, I started training in 2002. 2004 is when I had my first cap. And I mean, you know, we could count the number of fans and supporters that we had back then. And slowly it grew, but it never caught on, you know, it never caught fire, you know, brought impact to the country until that 2010 Suzuki Cup. And I mean, when everything happened, it was, you know, we couldn't take our smile off our faces. You know, I mean, you know, you bring up Ali. I remember that last 5 minutes against Vietnam, because we started playing together back in 2004, and we always said we'd come out and win a game and, you know, do this and do that. And I mean, when we beat Vietnam, we looked at each other and we had this big old smile on our face, and we're just like, you know, I mean, it was crazy because it was in the middle of the game and we were just like, holy, can't believe we're about to win this game. But then, I mean, it was a great feeling, you know, chills throughout the body every time. It was funny because they were showing the game on Star Sports the other day, and you know, we still get chills from it.
It's watching good. It again, yep. Remembering those times.
I'm sure this guy feels the same way when we talk about FIBA.
Oh, for sure. You know, anytime you see any type of international competition, you naturally bring yourself back to that moment. And I think Jola's, Kiefer's represented the country. We've all represented the country. I think it's a natural feeling just to kind of be overwhelmed once again. You know, it was probably the most overwhelming feeling, you know, from all the work you put in to finally getting that out of the way, and then just knowing how much it means to people outside of the team. It's not just about the 12 guys on the roster.
Speaking of which, were you aware of how big it was to beat Korea? Because, I mean, we all knew. Yeah. We all knew how big it was.
We watched the Korea curse
and
happen.
We all witnessed the curse over and over again. But you were still living in the States when most of that happened. So I'm sure you heard the stories from the rest of Gilas, but did it really, you know, did it eventually sink in before you actually played Korea?
Well, I think, you know, naturally I'm big on history, so I like to go back and, you know, kind of have a little background into what I'm getting into. And I had an understanding, but I think from playing with, being on Coach Chott's team in 07 and kind of seeing those defeats, being with Coach Yang when the team didn't really, you know, perform as well as the country would have liked, I kind of had that sense of how important, you know, these matchups were, and it made me want to go out and do everything I could to give back and do my part.
All right. We're going to be needing to take a quick break, but before that, a little bit of a welcome back. You're still watching Sports Desk's second anniversary special. It's time for our second topic of the show, and most sports in the Philippines gain popularity as a result of international success. Name it the Ascals, boxing with Manny Pacquiao, basketball. However, an exception to that rule is the rise of popularity of volleyball, specifically women's volleyball. So we were going to discuss why has women's volleyball, the popularity of women's volleyball risen without really international success, like the Ascals felt with, like Anton mentioned a while ago. Of course, Jolas and the guys remember what it's like for basketball as well. Aby, your thoughts now. Why the sudden rise of women's volleyball?
I think po yung pinakamalaking impact is when we fought against Ateneo back way back.
Way back.
Well, like 4 years ago, nag-start ata yung game namin with Ateneo, and we all know that Lasallians and Athenians has a really, really huge fan base. And then supporters from the alumni, masyadong malaki. And kahit lang dun sa loob ng sa campus, sobrang laki. Kaya nag-start sobrang daming nanonood. Like 20,000 plus ata po yung nanonood sa amin sa MOA Arena. Dun nag-start, as in, dun din naging catchy siya kasi yung mga bata, nagkakaroon sila ng interest sa volleyball kasi nakita nila na grabe yung passion na pinapakita ng every players from different universities.
You came along, you started playing volleyball in the Philippines at a time where parang perfect yung timing mo eh, na people started watching volleyball when you were already the leader in La Salle. and you finished college right when may liga ka nang papapsukan in PSL.
Apo.
Na instead of quitting your entire volleyball career after college, you got to move on to another league where you'll get to see everyone else that you played with in college move forward also. So ano masasabi mo in terms of, let's say, the future of Philippine volleyball compared to what you experienced when you were just starting out?
I can say na lalaki pa to at magiging malaki pa yung community namin sa volleyball kasi you get to play the same sport even if you're no longer playing for the for college. Plus, kahit working ka na, you also get the chance to play professionally. Sobrang laki kasi dumadami yung supporters, madami yung naniniwala at nag-i-invest for players to form a team. Plus, nakita mo yung mga kapwa mo Pilipino, kahit nasa abroad sila, sumusuporta sila. Kaya yun pa lang, parang sobrang everybody's really motivated and inspired to really pursue this this sport in our country.
Kiefer, you're but your mom obviously has a volleyball background. What has she said about as far as the popularity of the sport in the Philippines and all of a sudden volleyball is such a big deal here. What are her thoughts?
Actually, kay mama kasi sobrang naiinggit siya. Yun talaga ang pinaka sinasabi niya sa akin kasi to be able to play yun nga sinasabi ni Aby before pa lang in front of 22,000 crowd siguro pagpapalit niya lahat. Yun lang lagi niya sinasabi sa akin kasi kung siya nakapaglaro doon talagang ibibigay niya doon talaga lahat. So very happy siya kasi ngayon she's still working around volleyball doing analyst pa rin. So natutuwa talaga siya pag nakikita niya yung mga girls na lalo na yung men's ngayon, uprising na din, di ba? So, hindi lang yun. Nakikita niya rin kung paano nag-grow yung volleyball. So, very happy pa rin naman talaga siya.
Gabe, you're a fan of many sports. Right. You follow his baseball. You know, you're all athletes on your sport. Right. Have you taken notice on the volleyball scene in the Philippines?
No, I definitely have. And I think, I hate to compare it to an episode or something that's happened in the States, but I think back to the national team, the women's soccer team. When they kind of, who was it? Was it Brandi Chastain? Was that her name?
Why do you have to remember Brandi? Why?
No, I'm saying everybody talks players, about that moment. You know, she
have
scores
to remember
a goal.
Her. She pulled the shirt off.
Really, that was like the highlight of women's soccer.
You're viewing soccer.
I'm just saying. Lay, I'm sorry, baby. I'm sorry, baby. I'm sorry. No, I really liken it to that because like. Exactly like Aby said, that one moment 4 years ago, you have LaSalle Ateneo right there, and that's something that sparks it. I think it sparks interest in little girls who might have grew up being basketball fans, but there's no real, prominent basketball figure for them to look up to, and now they see volleyball players, they see Aby and say, Mom, Dad, take me to a game. And next they're bringing friends and things like that. So I think it's a big moment for the sport, and I think it's going to continue to progress.
Actually, kasi yung sa kanila, grabe. Hindi katulad sa basketball, yung fan base, alumni. Alumni.
Oh,
yung sa kanila, grabe.
Lahat ng klaseng tao.
Grabe sa kanila.
May grabe. No,
nanganganak. Promise.
That's the term.
That's the term.
Yung fans ko yan, fans mo, Aby, diba?
Yeah,
hindi naman lahat
gross.
Nasan eh.
Apo. Yung nakakatawa.
Especially yung mga bata na girls.
Crazy.
At saka nakakatawa. Kasi parang, kala mo tagal sa sayo kung paano sila makipaglaban para sa'yo. Sobrang dami. Kasi saka ang pinakamadami namin mga fans, yung mga bata po talaga. Aspiring volleyball athletes
ako,
talaga.
Ako, fan ako. Bata. Ayan. Bata.
Oo.
Ayan na. Bata.
Nalaglag ka na yun sa itchy. Kakambyo mo pa.
No, for the record, ako, atinista ako. But I'm such a fan of Aby because she's, she's a fiery competitor. She is ultra emotional when she competes. I can't help but admire and be a fan of her. Kahit green Lady Archer siya, okay lang. I mean, and I think that speaks volumes about how volleyball transcends yung diba, number one sports atin, basketball. Askel's now pushing football there, but yung volleyball, the growth, it's just fantastic. Mm-hmm. It's phenomenal.
Which leads me to the question though that
will we see a volleyball team from the Philippines make it on the world stage? I mean, we've seen in basketball, we've seen it in football, but when will we see that in volleyball?
Now I can tell you guys because we're just
ball.
Starting.
We're just starting. Yeah.
But then, hindi siya imposible.
Okay. Yeah.
Because you know, lahat naman ng mga Pilipino, we are really, really competitive, whether it's international or a local kind of.
Now, speaking of which, growing up, and I guess, Jolas, we can start with you though. Growing up, did you dream of playing? Okay, I want to grow up. I want to play. For the PBA, or was there a time when you said, you know what, I want to play for the Philippines? What was the motivation?
Yeah, not for the PBA, but for the national team. I only found out that I was good enough to play in the PBA when I got to the national team, because I don't know if I was shortchanging myself. Na parang I had very low self confidence. But before I got to the national team, I never saw myself playing in the PBA. But growing up, I was watching. Crispa.
Full time.
Ato, sila Freddy, and I was a big fan of Ato. That's the reason why I was number 6, other than Dr. J. So I always wanted to be in the PBA, but I didn't know if I had the skills to be there. Not until I went to the national team.
That's something, right? I mean, it's like, do you grow up like Kiefer?
Branded immediately as the phenom?
Yeah.
Do you grow into the sport where you think you're not that good until you realize, oh, I am?
Plus, you also, did you think, okay, I want to make it to the PBA or I want to play for the Philippine team? That's just because, you know, the volleyball, we don't have that yet. We don't have, I want to play for the Philippine team. The Ascos, we do. Gilas, we do. But you know, for the guys growing up, was that a motivation?
Yeah, that was the same case for me. Growing up, I really wanted to represent the country. I mean, yun na yung pinaka ano mo eh. Kumbaga, level yung sarili mo, i-gauge mo yung sarili mo pag makapasok ka sa national team. Kasi best of the best na yun eh. I mean, to represent the country, bibigay talaga kung sino yung mga pinaka magagaling. So that was really my goal, to represent the country. And then, yun nga, with one moment lang nung game ko against Lasal, dun ko lang din na-realize na, okay, dun din na-brand si Phenom na kung ano man ako ngayon. Pero yung goal ko talaga was to really be the best that I can be in order to represent the country. I mean, yun na yung pinaka-ano sa akin. Kaya hindi ko talaga, once natawagin ako ng country, kahit nung youth pa, hindi talaga ako nagdadalawang isip maglaro for
sure, Philippines. 100%.
But it's different now because the national team members, they were pretty much handpicked, right? But back in the day, it was open tryout.
Yeah,
everyone goes. I didn't know Alvin when he was trying out together with me, Sila Jerry. Of course, they were stars in their own college teams. But when we got to Rizal Memorial, we were about 100. I'm from Cagayan de Oro. I'm from way out, okay? And everyone's competing for a spot in the 12 member lineup. And every day, you have to go to the newspaper to see if your name's still there. So it was kind of an anxious moment for us, but it was a thrill. So, I mean, like, it was really, when you get there, you know that you worked really hard, you earned it.
All right, more from our guests when we return as we talk about the UAAP. This is Sports Desk, keep it here. Welcome back to Sports Desk. One recent issue that stirred up the sports community was the announcement by the UAAP regarding the gradual ban on foreign players, garnering either all-out support or passional dissent. Now, of course, we have a pretty good panel here. We have the Phil Foreigners, and we have the Born and Raised. So we do have to ask this. Is it right to ban teams from having foreign players in their lineups?
College lineup.
Who wants to go first?
Let's go.
Anton wants to answer. I mean, you go around the world, you know. I mean, college-wise, they always allow foreign players. Mm-hmm. I mean, it doesn't matter whether you're of that, I guess, that country or not. You're still allowed to go over there, and whether you go there for school or whether you go there to play the sport, I mean, you should be allowed to play the sport. I mean, it's just stopping people from reaching their goals and, you know, dreams and stuff like that. Because, I mean, you know, that's a step to get to your dream, you know. Coming over here, I wasn't going to college, made the national team, went over to the States, got a scholarship, and that allowed me to, you know, reach my goals to come out here and play professionally. You know, I mean, it just lets you, gives you an extra step to get to where you want to be.
So in a sense, you were an import in the States.
Pretty much. after I started playing for the national team over here.
Okay,
just I'm Filipino now.
Kiefer, what are your thoughts on this? Because this kind of affects you more than anybody here. Though,
you're
right?
Still playing.
Yeah, well, siguro kasi for me, with that, siguro positively ko siya kinukuha kasi eventually we have to face bigger, taller, stronger opponents just like imports. I mean, it's a good practice for us locals na we get used to seeing players bigger than the usual Filipinos. Siguro, the negative thing about it lang is kasi siya, nawawala ng spot yung ano, yung local na malalaki.
Okay.
So,
and nakita mo na nangyari yun?
Of course.
As in, parang may mga kilala ka na, ito pwede sana lalo, kaya lang malaki.
Kulang sa exposure, kulang sa skills, kasi yun nga, hindi masyado nakakapaglaro. Pero, yun lang siguro yung pinaka-negative effect niya, hindi sa laro eh, more on the future when it comes to the national team. We end up trying to naturalize players. Although, nakakatulong talaga na may ganun ka. Pero, yung local push natin, siguro ilan lang eh. I mean, June Mar, Greg, Japet, yung malalaki talaga, di ba? Na could make a big impact when it comes to the national team. Tapos, kami, pagdating sa collegiate, good practice talaga. I think that's the best part for us. I don't take it na bawal, banning. I think it's normal. Yung nasabi ni Anton, if you play basketball, you should be allowed to play basketball.
Yeah.
Whether you're 6'5 or 7 feet coming from another country, you should be allowed.
So in the finals, in the UAP this season, when you took it to the basket, went up for that layup.
If it was a local,
you would have scored.
No, not really, not really. Kasi yung hindi ko rin, kung si Troy din yun, block pa rin naman.
Pa rin si Troy,
di ba? So, hindi ko rin talaga may iwas yun, di ba? So, ganun lang talaga. I mean, there are a lot of means and ways to get around the basket even though the guy is bigger than you. You just have to find a way. Have to be willing to find a way talaga.
Jojo, what's your view on this? I mean, you've seen it. You've seen this develop. So we're very curious to what you have to say about this.
It's obviously a very touchy subject. Because I had an experience before when I was in Ateneo. I played for 2 seasons in Ateneo, and we had to compete against FEU. They had Anthony Williams, who's a 6'4", black American also. I don't know how he got into the team, but for me, what's happening right now is they're getting in, they're actually recruiting. They're so-called imports already.
Yeah.
So there's really no difference between college and PBA anymore when it comes to having reinforcement, because I think they get recruited first as athletes, of course.
Yes.
But what's happening right now is they're coming into the country and we hear news that they're not really going into the schools and studies. They're just here to play. So they're considered as professional imports, and for me that's a huge difference than being a student athlete.
Yeah,
so for me, I would agree in a sense that they take away a spot for the local, but at the same time, if they come here, they have to study first and then play at the same time. You have to be a student athlete.
So like you, I'm so happy that you mentioned that, because that's one of the things that's a very touchy in this situation, because when you're a student athlete, you're part of a student, you're part of the student body. Whether you're from here, you're from the States, you're from wherever, as long as you're part of the student body, you should be able to participate in any extracurricular activity, be it the debate team, the glee club, whatever, or volleyball, or football, or basketball. I mean, that's only fair. Is it okay to say that? Is it fair to say that? Otherwise, it's a little bit of a discrimination when you don't allow that foreign student athlete to play a sport or be part of an organization because he's not from the Philippines.
No, I agree 100%. I think Joel has hit it right on the head with how things should go. You can't stop somebody from getting an education, you know, whether it's bettering themselves, they can't get the same education in their country. But at the end of the day, I think it comes down to, are they here to get their education, or are they here to
get some money and then go back home. You know, I think there's been success stories also. There's been guys who've come out here as imports and still have been very successful and contributed to the Filipino community as well and really embraced it. And it's hard to say, you know, are these guys coming out for that or coming out just to play some basketball?
Now, before we went on air, Aby had something, we were discussing this a little bit, and you had something really, you know, what interesting to say about playing with imports or foreign players.
Well, on my part, because I got the chance to play with imports also, and on my experience, nakaka-inspire siya. It's really inspiring to play with imports that really better than you, because parang at some point, parang inisip mo na, okay, I should not rely my playing capabilities to our imports. Parang kailangan gumawa din ako ng move ko para maabot ko yung galing nila. And it's really, really inspiring kasi parang nagkakaroon ka ng kalaban. Kahit kalakampi mo siya, parang kalaban para maging competitive ka and maging better player ka. You train hard and then you push yourself and you just keep doing so much para maging mahusay ka na malalaro. And yun nga, gaya po ng sinabi ko kanina, parang okay din siya for us Filipinos na i-embrace natin yung fact na meron na nga dito sa country natin.
But another side of this is that I guess would you guys consider that our education system in the Philippines, our schools, are world class? That perhaps that you know foreign people want to come here to study and then they just eventually want to play ball, want to play volleyball, want to play football. I mean, is it also fair to say that people want to go to Ateneo, La Salle, or wherever?
Yeah, sure. But if the athletes come here because they have an agent to come here, that's a different story.
Yes. Okay. It's a totally different problem. Yeah. It's a totally different issue because Kirk Long, who grew up here. He, you know, technically he was a foreign student athlete, so he had to follow some rules that he couldn't be on the court at the same time with
Zion
other
foreign. Yeah, and I think just Zion.
Yeah, that there was that one instance. I think it was against La Salle.
Yeah, before for quite some time, exam says sa court nagkamali si Coach Norman. Pero yeah, Kirk really sacrificed a lot.
Yeah.
Kasi I think si Kirk mas matagal pa sa Pilipinas kaysa sa akin. Mm. So at least ngayon nabigyan siya ng edge na nakakapaglaro siya sa D-League. I mean, for him, malaking bagay na yun. Kasi yun nga, marami na talaga siya natulong, especially for us at Ateneo talaga. He gave a lot of chances for Ateneo. So it's just fair for him. And he served his dues in school. He really was a student athlete. Yeah.
And he played two sports.
Yeah, he even played baseball during his final year. So for Kirk, I think yun different issues here. Siguro kay Kirk, kasi di ba tagal talaga siya dito.
Okay, all right. No, I'm just no. It's
processing.
No, it's fascinating because yung dalawang student athlete, ito current, ito kakatapos lang mag-student, and they are actually in favor of generally speaking, wala silang problema. Kung may, foreign student, I would really say foreign student. Preferably, I don't want to call them imports.
Yeah, me too.
If they're enrolled, they're not imports. They're student athletes, just like all the athletes of all sports. And if they're there, they recruit sila, so long as they go to class. Kasi buti lang, lahat ng local pumapasok, di ba? Tama ba?
Hindi rin! Oh, Jonathan!
Side story.
Wait.
Disclaimer.
We'll be right back after a short break. You're watching Sports News. Keep it here. Wow. Sports Death, turn 2. Special continues. Now we want to pick the brains of our guests on what they believe needs to be done to continue to elevate sports in the Philippines. All right. So this is a nice little topic, but let's start with Anton on this one. Not just football, okay? I mean, we're talking sports in general. Think about it in the terms of the Asian Games,
Sea Games, Asian Games,
Olympics. We haven't even won a gold yet. So what should be done, in your opinion?
Well, first, I gotta say, Filipino people are the greatest fans, you know, greatest supporters, because no matter what, when we play for country, they're always supporting, you know, whether we win, lose, draw, it don't matter, they're always there. But to keep things going and to make us do better and grow, I mean, I think a lot comes from success of the national team, you know. With the Suzuki Cup going on, we got the semifinals, on Saturday?
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, if we could come out and win one of those, you know, the Suzuki Cup, then it'll change everything for football once again. And that's what you need, you know. You need something like that to pick up a sport, because it shows that, you know, you're successful in it and people love success.
Yeah.
Well, for the basketball players here, obviously we have different generations, but
really,
our generation.
but that makes your answers better though, because basketball already has such a huge fan base. It's just the way things have progressed through the years. That what else do you think can be done for the sport in this country?
So where do we start?
Where do we start? Do we start from youngest to...
Well, youngest, di Jojo.
Veteran or...
Well, I think in terms of training and facilities and sports science, I think there's been a progression even since I've been here. And I think it's big in terms of, you know, players' recovery, our health and things like that. I think guys are taking pretty good care of themselves. You look at Ossie in the league, he's 40 years old running around like he's 20, yeah. And I don't think it's a fluke, you know. It's really the training and the things that are available for him, and he's taking full advantage. So I think that's going to play a big part, you know, in kind of maximizing the player and getting everything out of our players. Not just in basketball, just overall.
Across the board.
Also, for me, also in general, not only for basketball, I think it has to be with the in training. You have to put yourself in a position to be successful, and it starts with training. So if you're an athlete, not only as a basketball player, for example, you're a weightlifter, rowing team ka, pero yung training mo, kung yung kumpiyansa mo sa sarili mo, na you're not guaranteed to get a gold medal, but if you know you're confident in yourself that you're in a better position to win that gold, it starts with training, starts with good funding, yung tinitiran mo, healthy, kinakain mo, you can eat talagang proper food. Come to that competition, you're not guaranteed the gold, but once you get into that competition, ready ka. Yun yung pinaka for me na mabibigay mo talaga to get the national team a better chance of winning.
Jojo?
Totally agree. I mean, everything has to start with training. You see the really good athletes, they started when they were young. And for us, the problem with the country right now, across the board, all the sports, we're talking about national team here. We don't have a solid program. And we always hear about the stories about the athletes not getting their proper due training, allowances, because they get to the other, I don't know where. But we have to start there. I mean, I don't know where we can find people that are straight. I'm not saying that they're all crooked, but we have to have a facility where everyone is catered to. Maybe a sports training center where every sport is there. I'm looking at actually Clark, that you have a football field, you have basketball, everything. Every sport should be there in one area.
Para academy.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Other countries have that.
Definitely.
Korea, China.
So basically, Rizal Memorial is basically outdated.
Yeah, this.
Paano pa ni Jojo yun eh?
If Babe Ruth can hit a home run in Rizal Memorial, you should change it. Yeah.
No, it stays there, but the facilities will be somewhere outside where it's away from the city.
Okay.
Right. Oh. Well, for me, I'll put it this way. The heart to win will make you to championship, but the will to train will make you a champion. It's always like that.
That is the next quote of the night for Sports Yes. Thank you so much for providing
the heart to train will make you a champion.
It's tweetable. Anton,
say it on your
phone. Tweet it. Social media.
Okay.
The heart to win will make you to championship, but the will to train will make you a champion.
Got it,
that's
good.
It.
Got it.
Simple, got but that? Boom.
Tell that to Coach Ying.
Hey, Coach! In Tagalog.
I have a quote for you.
I got Abby. We'll figure it out.
But let's see, for volleyball. So it's so popular now.
you have young girls, in-idolize kayo, they want to be like you. But, kunyari yan, in your opinion, how do we win international championships for volleyball?
I think it still boils down with proper training.
Is it training here or dapat training abroad?
Maybe some exposure?
We tried that eh. We trained in Japan. And then, yun, yung mga different tricks nila and other training programs, kinuha namin yun because alam naman natin na kailangan natin ng bago at bagong programa. So now, I think kasama pa din yung sa training yung disiplina. Kasi for a player, parang there are players that are like, I want to get rid of training. I want to play. I just want to play. Pero pangit yun na ugali. Kasi for a player, kung meron kang disiplina na mag-training ka, kahit na napapagod ka, naiiyak ka na, dugot pawis na yung binubuhos mo everyday, hindi ka dapat tuminto. At hindi ka dapat tumintong matuto. You should always experiment something for yourself to improve and develop your skills.
Does the exposure, did it help you guys, the exposure? I mean, I know Ateneo goes to the States a lot before the season starts. How has that exposure helped for you and the team and eventually, of course, everybody else, and hopefully that it elevates to the national level?
Oh, yung exposure na yun, yung pa Las Vegas kami every year.
Yeah.
Parang nakita naman ng iba siguro kasi
yung
results nun, yeah. Nag-five championships sila, kami. Tapos being able to play with the best, you know, athletes in the world, probably the NBA players, yung mga magpapadraft pa lang. I was fortunate enough to play with Kawhi Leonard, Dion Waiters, and they were still doing their pre-draft workouts. So, yun pa lang, mapupush mo talaga yung sarili mo. So, yung exposure internationally gets you the mindset of, this is what I have to be. This is what I have to do in order for me and my team to be successful.
That's the barometer.
Yeah, na, yun
that's
na
the barometer. Okay, let's get some parting shots.
Before we go, again, well, the Ascals are part of the Suzuki Cup, rain or shine, FPSA, I don't know. Before we go, guys, your last words to our audience.
Ton. You're passing it.
I'm resting. That's all.
Oh, okay.
Please rest. Okay.
Okay.
Let's start with Jola. So, parting
final
shots.
Words.
Yeah, final
words from you.
Well, we're all here as sports people, and our country loves sports, and it's the one thing that unites everyone.
Yes.
And whether you're dyan ka lang sa Cali or kung saan ka, I mean, it unites us all. And let's just bring everything, let's give everything puso natin. If you play for the national team, then everyone will be happy.
All right. Keith?
Same lang. Since yun talaga eh, pagdating sa sports, ito talaga yung nagpapa-unite sa ating lahat. Kumilaban si Manny, nanonood tayong lahat. Pero same with just basketball, football, volleyball. I guess with the proper support of the Filipino crowd, malayo talaga mararating natin lahat.
Alright.
At yun, importante talaga na makakuha ka ng suporta from the Filipinos na mga kababayan mo. Kasi talaga masarap maglaro para sa bayan na may mga naniniwalang mga kababayan.
Alright. Gabe?
First, congrats to you guys on the 2-year anniversary, and
thank you for having us.
But no, I completely agree that it's an honor if you represent the country. You're chosen, you know, it's not something you can run away from. You're chosen for a reason, and do it with all your heart.
Don, you can't pass the ball anymore.
No, sorry. Wow, congratulations. Oh, just like Gabe said, congratulations and thanks for having us, right? No kicking over here. I mean, playing for the national team, it's an honor. Thank you all for always supporting us, no matter whether we win, lose, or draw. But if you're an athlete and you're young, keep playing, keep practicing, go reach for your goals, and you know, one day you could be one of these guys over here.
You could be Anton del Rosario.
Yeah.
Not Ali Borromeo. Anton del Rosario.
Gino Rufino.
All right. Thank you, Anton. Thank you, Gabe, Aby, Kiefer, Jolas, and of course, Mico Halili, Daddy Minion. Thank you.
Thank you for putting up with me for the last how many months?
Yep, that is all the time we have for you guys tonight. And of course, we want to thank our guests for being here in this special moment. And to our staff, our crew, to my co-host Gina Rufino, and to everyone who's been part of the sports desk from day one, and of course, our audience, our fans, thank you for watching us every single night.
Wow.
This is for you. Flowers.
Thanks. Wow. I feel so special. Wow.
Do I get flowers?
I feel so
special. Wala.
Do I get something? Okay. I don't get flowers.
Remember, you can log on to our website, www.sportsdesk.ph. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. I'm Nico Hanji.
And I'm Gina Rufino. Before we go, we'll leave you with a quote from John Wooden, who once said, "There are many things that are essential to arriving at true peace of mind. One of the most important is faith." Like Cesca said, thank you very much to our guests, and thank you very much to the team behind the cameras, the cameramen, the PAs, the writers, the people in the control room, the editors, the graphics. Thank you very much to everybody for 2 years and putting up with my mood swings sometimes. Thank you, everybody, and be safe, Philippines. Of course, thank you to our viewers. Good night.